Jim Jackson's A-list.
A matchup here. Now, both guys won't be guarding each other, but Corey Dixon, a skilled, smart, stretch four who loves to put the ball on the deck. Hasn't shot a three yet, but can shoot up to 17 feet, so will be a good matchup. Keep Appen trying to get his rhythm back. Over the last two games, only shooting, only scoring 6 points a game and 0 for 7 from his last three-point shooting. So let's see early on if he can get back into a rhythm.
Let's take a look at the Buffalo Wild Wings starting lineup. Outside of Dixon and Appling, what are you watching in this Buffalo Wild Wings starting lineup?
Well, very important when you talk about Michigan State is the health of Gary Harris. You saw when he was healthy, 19.65 assists against Texas, what he can bring to the table. The coaching staff seems to believe that he's regaining his form, so let's keep an eye on how Gary is moving on the court.
Michigan State at 10-1, New Orleans at 3-4. Bo Borowski, Tim Stewart, Johnny Wilkins are officials today for the final non-conference game before the Big Ten season opens for Michigan State. Fifth-ranked Spartans led by Tom Izzo. We'll see him in a moment. Mark Schlesinger, the third-year head coach of the Privateers of New Orleans, a native of Bloomington, Indiana. We had a great chat with Coach Schlesinger earlier. A lot of good stories to tell you throughout the broadcast today. Yes. He was a lot of fun, and it's always fun to get the chance to catch up with the head man of Michigan State, Tom Izzo. Not sure there's a more gracious head coach in all of college basketball with his time or his information.
No, he is. And going back to Coach Schlesinger, was it more fun meeting him or his mother, you know, before the game?
Well, I had no problem with his mom. She was not a huge fan of Jim Jackson.
No, she said I was one of the few Buckeyes that she could tolerate, okay, but she liked me a lot better now than my playing days at Ohio State.
She's been an usher, has mom, for 33 going on 34 years at Indiana. She watched Jim Jackson tear up the Hoosiers a little bit. Jumper for Corey Dixon. We talked about him at the top of the broadcast. He's got a score. He averages 15 points per game.
But more importantly for Corey Dixon, he has to stay out of foul trouble. Talking to assistant coach Kenyon Spears, did you see Adrian Payne kind of get up in the air? I said, what's your game plan to get Corey off early? He said, keep him out of foul trouble because he will pick up some of those cheapy fouls, which you can't do because you need him on the floor for his production.
Here's Isaac Mack, the senior from Indianapolis. A long three from Mack, and that's a little bit strong and was early in the shot clock. Here's Appling on the drive to the basket. Appling getting out and running, and Appling gives Michigan State a 2-0 lead.
Well, the coaching staff for New Orleans wants to control pace, and the way you do that is to take smart shots. That shot that time by Mack was a long, early contested three-pointer, which allows Michigan State, as you see, to get out of transition.
There's Darren Becker with the long three, the former Dayton hoopster, now with New Orleans, and he gives New Orleans the early lead. Valentine looking down low to Payne. Payne in the post going to work. Cannot finish down low. Got his own back, and Payne had it knocked away. Crowd wanted a foul on Dixon. They didn't get it.
At that time, Adrian just has to finish. I think he was trying to attempt to go for the dunk. You see a strip right there by Keith Appling, but just has to finish. And
Gavin Schilling checking in for Michigan State. Two Spartans heading for the bench. Adrian Payne will be the one who sits down. Alex Gauna thought he was leaving.
And Tom coaching as usual, talking to Adrian about finishing inside.
Darren Becker with another quick three. The rebound to Gary Harris. Now Appling will try to push again, getting the tempo going.
And that's something that Coach Izzo wants to get back. You see Gary Harris spot up for three, but he wants to see his team get back in transition.
A nice look inside from Valentine to Schilling.
And that's what happens when you push the ball early in the offense. You get a quick shot. Guys are not matched up. Offensive rebound. Now you can get something easy inside.
And that's why Coach Schlesinger was concerned that New Orleans limit those transition opportunities by controlling tempo a little bit.
Well, you do that by being smart. You utilize the shot clock to your advantage. And don't bail yourself out by taking the first available shot. You can get some of these shots anytime, force Michigan State to work defensively.
Shot clock at six. Looking down low to Dixon. The fadeaway rebounded by Gauna. Long pass ahead, Valentine. Valentine on the drive with the finger roll. The tip by Valentine, no good. And New Orleans the other way with McPherson. Mack, the three. And it rattles home for Isaac Mack.
And that's something that this New Orleans team can do. They want to get out and run. But again, you have to be strategic if you're New Orleans, when you run and when you pull back.
Appling Harris in the corner. And the rebound to Corey Dixon. 6-4 New Orleans early. McPherson on the run, and a foul is going to be called. A little push by McPherson. The State Farm State of Success looking ahead to conference play for Michigan State. Jim Jackson, what do they need to do to be successful in conference?
Get back to Michigan State basketball. Physical rebound without fouling. Imposing your will. That's Dawson inside, Payne inside, Costello inside, using those big bodies. But also Spartan defense. We're accustomed to seeing this team in the past get multiple stops. One, two, three, four stops, and then you score. That's playing physical without fouling. Coach Izzo talked about him probably overcoaching a little bit due to the new rules, but he wants to get back to that physical nature of their defensive sets.
Harris with the open three, and Payne right back off the bench battling Schilling. Schilling gets the rebound. And a whistle and a foul is going to be called on Schilling for the illegal screen. So New Orleans will regain the possession and a 6-4 lead for the Privateers.
Having had a lot of these Michigan State early non-conference games over the years, it's interesting to see how sometimes they play to the level of competition until they kind of get heated. I'd like to see this Michigan State team really impose their will early in the game instead of kind of waiting for New Orleans to kind of make a run at the Spartans.
Harris with the three in transition and the rebound inside for Kevin Hill. Kevin Hill wearing a little bit of a helmet. You see it there as he has the ball driving into the paint, that sort of protective gear. It's a soft cushioned headpiece he wears as a precaution to avoid concussions. And his team at the timeout with a 2-point lead in East Lansing.
There's a family just like...
Start 2-for-9 from the floor.
Yeah, and 0-for-4 from the three-point line. But I do like the tempo of the game, the pace of play. Michigan State looking to get out and run, but you don't want to settle and fall in love with the three-point line, in particular when you have the size and athleticism inside, work inside out, and maybe then those three-pointers begin to fall.
Travis Trice into the ball game right now for Michigan State. Russell Bird on the floor as well. Tom Izzo going to his bench off the timeout. Rebounding battle being won early by Michigan State. They've missed all four of their three-point attempts, all from Gary Harris.
Yeah, they had good shots. Again, in transition, a lot of kickouts, cross court. But like I said, the strength of this Michigan State team is getting to the basket, using that size and athleticism inside. Getting some point pings, some points in the paint.
Mack, pass Trice all the way to the basket with a left hand, and it's good. Isaac Mack going right past Trice.
Well, I like a communication, plus the weak side was married to their guy and not in the lane to cut off that driving basket that time by Mack.
Appling trying to go to work against Gill. The floater blocked the goaltend. Corey Dixon with the goaltend.
I talked about getting back to Michigan State, but this is not their defense right here. Inside, you have to be inside the lane. Adrian has to provide some kind of support so when he comes around the screen, somebody's there. But the middle is wide open, and no one is there communicating. The back line of the defense is very important because you see everything. That time, Michigan State just fell asleep on the baseline.
Hill off on the three, out of bounds to Michigan State. New Orleans 1-9 all time against the Big Ten. Their only win came against Penn State. That was in overtime back in 1984. They've not had a whole lot of success. Lost earlier this year to Minnesota 80-65, but shot over 55% in the second half. And Coach Schlesinger telling us earlier that they gained a lot from the way they played in the second half of that game.
Well, coaches judge improvement differently. It's not always wins and losses. It's during courses of the game, how well do you play? How well do you execute? And that's what Coach Schlesinger was, I think, referring to.
The rebound by Appling off the miss. Michigan State trailing early in this one. Neither team shooting particularly well from the floor to start things off. On the drive, Valentine trying to wriggle his way to the basket, couldn't get there. Valentine back to work again, and he walked with it. Fourth turnover for Michigan State in the early going.
Is it me, Kevin, or does Michigan State seem to be a little bit, half a second out of sync? It's not like they're not getting the kind of shots they want, but it doesn't like they feel comfortable, in particular, finishing around the basket as of yet.
Well, as somebody who played a lot of years at the college and pro level, how difficult is it to come back from that layoff and get back to work at a high level? Nice block from behind by Adrian Payne. High-level defense there.
Well, each team is different, and that's the beauty you see keep happening in transition. That's when the trailing three is most effective, when the defense is below the free throw line. But each team is different, and it goes back to what kind of practice and focus you had when you come back from that break.
Appling's first three made in two-plus games. Long two for Dixon. Can't get the roll. Offensive rebound from Sion. Gives it off underneath, and McPherson can't finish.
And you can't give up those bunnies, in particular when you're playing against this Michigan State team at home.
Payne has it knocked away from behind, and New Orleans up the floor again.
And that's what I mean. Just half a second, you know, just that's a pass and catch that normally Adrian Payne, you know, wouldn't give up.
Five turnovers already for Michigan State. That's an awfully high number for the Spartans this early in the game, especially. Offensive rebound, then a travel on Sion.
Defense, Sparty defense here. Looks like a drive negated by Adrian Payne, and then in transition, you get the defense down a little bit, back pass to the trailer. Opens up the three-point shot for Keith Appling.
A good start for Appling. 7 points, and you mentioned it at the top of the broadcast. Appling had been struggling coming in. You wanted to see how he started. He has started extremely well for Michigan State.
Well, he hasn't shied away from it, Kevin. And I know you've seen it before from a player who's been struggling. They'll hesitate a little bit, but Keith early on is looking to be aggressive offensively, which is a good sign for Sparty.
10 on the shot clock. Back out to Trice around the Gauna screen. 5 to shoot for Trice, matched up against the bigger Dixon. 2 to shoot. Nice pass down to Bird, but Bird's extra pass came too late. If Bird takes it up, he's got a shot there to beat the shot clock, but the extra pass was 1 too many.
And not recognizing the shot clock, and he only had a few seconds left. And somebody has to call it out on the court. I don't care who it is. Okay, you got a second. Shoot it. And right there, not able to complete the play because of a shot clock violation. Bird has to be more aware of that.
Ellis was aware, played the hot potato game, tried to get the ball out of his hand as quick as he could. Sion inside, a little bit strong. Good rebound underneath by Dixon, and he'll go to the line for a chance at a three-point play. Corey Dixon, 3 double-doubles already this year, working hard to get that offensive rebound, and Dixon giving the Privateers the 1-point lead for a chance at a 3-point play when we return.
Mine was earned orbiting the moon in 19.
Where the coaching gear.
But how about this? She said she was so excited to finally see Tom Izzo up close. Because at Indiana, she's at the opposite end and can never get this close. So she said, I love my son, but I'm just excited to see Coach Izzo.
Well, we wanted to send our best wishes to Grandma Geneva as well. She is watching at home, talking with Coach Schlesinger.
Like
before. No, she's not a fan at all of Jim Jackson.
No.
But she watches hoops from sunup to sundown and then reports the scores to her grandson every single night as the foul is called on Terrence Sion. She's 94 years old. She watches from the East Coast game to the West Coast game, writes them all down on her tablet, and then talks to Mark afterwards and says, here's what happened on the day in basketball.
And she still loves Robert Montgomery Knight, her idol.
Inside, Harris has it knocked away. Bird back out to Trice.
Well, let's see if right now what New Orleans loves to do out of a timeout is switch up the defense. You see in the zone right now to kind of keep Michigan State off balance. Just see how Michigan State handles the defense and good drive. Get the ball in the middle, and now you can attack the seams. Russell Bird doing an outstanding job of being patient and then exploiting the defense. Again, get the ball in the middle. Now you have options. If you're not stopped off the dribble, now you can attack either with the dribble or the pass.
First foul on Darren Becker, sending Russell Bird to the line. He's only had 4 free throw attempts this year. Bird 2 for 4. And Russell Bird, the junior out of Fort Wayne, Indiana, missing that first one. Bird's been a guy who's just battled foot problems for a good portion of his early career. This last offseason was really his first healthy offseason as a Spartan.
And the frustrating part about a player, in particular when you're injured, you see Gallo right there with the offensive rebound, is that you never know what your potential could have been because of those type of injuries. And that kind of stays with you after your playing career is, you know, complete.
Yeah, just because you're healthy from a foot injury doesn't mean that the effects aren't there.
Exactly.
And there's a nice little pin by Russell Bird. Possession arrow will give it to Michigan State.
Well, just watch Russell Bird that time react to the basketball. Okay, right now Gano should have just played straight up. But Russell Bird not giving up on the play, rotating from the free throw line, able to get the block without the foul, most importantly.
And Bird gets some congratulations with some good minutes as he heads to the bench. Trice and Ellis in the backcourt. Payne up front with Harris and Gauna.
Yeah, a little 1-2-2 half-court press here.
They break it, and Gauna finishes.
And you break presses, Kevin, with the pass, not with the dribble. And that time, being able to see over the defense, exploit it, get an easy basket. Excellent execution by Michigan State.
Kevin Hill fouled by Gauna on his way to the basket. Second on Gauna.
Or sharing the basketball. That's how you beat a zone. All right? In the middle of the court, Gary Harris turns, faces, squares up. Finds Gauna on the backcourt. But you see right here, here's the open area. You can't match up. And that's where you want to get the basketball. And now once you turn inside, it's a 2-on-1 on the backside. Excellent pass and excellent finish that time by Michigan State.
Well, nobody shares better than Michigan State in the conference this year. 19 assists per game. They lead the Big Ten. They're second in the nation. Not a surprise to see Michigan State pass the ball that well, because that's what they've done all year long, is distribute and share.
Right. The game is a lot easier when you're able to distribute the basketball. You play unselfishly. And guess what, Kevin? You'll play more efficient basketball when you do that.
Nice catch in the corner. And the jumper no good. Rebound to Harris. Harris trying to push. McPherson got in his way. Harris still driving it. And the jumper no good. Rebound to Bourgeois. McPherson. Step back three.
And see, that's the kind of shot right there that will coach Sessinger and the coaching staff. You don't need that right now. That's what he's saying. Okay, now it turns over to the opposite end where Michigan State can now take advantage of it, because it was a quick shot. You don't have defensive balance in the backcourt. Result, you give up a three.
And the timeout taken by New Orleans, and Mark Schlesinger none too happy with his team for exactly what you were saying. They shoot that quick jumper, and on the other end, it turns into points for Michigan State.
Well, it's easy to see. Now, you watch right here. Okay, the shot goes up. No one is there. Okay, but on the opposite end, look where nobody is around the shooter, because you're out of position. Because you know why, Kevin? You didn't expect that quick shot to go up, so now your defensive balance is not there. And that's Michigan State taking advantage of this. Just get it up the court quick on the pass.
16-10 Michigan State, the 7-0 run over the last 2:07, propelling the Spartans into the lead. And they're doing it on the glass as well, Jimmy. 19-8, out-rebounding New Orleans, and that's what they expect to do. But for a team that's had its ups and downs, at least early in the non-conference on the boards, it's good to see for Michigan State that they're hitting the glass as hard as they are.
And rebounding, Kevin, as you know, is not just your post play. It's your guards cleaning up the long rebounds, those 50-50 balls that you need to get. The guards are beginning to now get more engaged and rebound the ball a lot better as well.
So pivotal moment early for New Orleans, playing even through the first 9 minutes or so, but a 7-0 run over the last two for Michigan State. Their biggest lead of the late afternoon, and another turnover pushing the other way as Russell Bird. The bounce to Applin, driving it all the way up. Payne with the finish. Another transition two. That's the first two for Adrian Payne.
God, what a luxury it is when you can just throw the ball at the rim and have an athletic post player that can catch and finish.
And the fourth turnover, an unforced error for New Orleans.
But head up, Russell Bird over to Keith Applin, who's eyeing the defense, but also where his man is at, which is at Adrian Payne. Easy assist, easy basket, but a classic fast break opportunity for Michigan State.
10-2 on fast break points, and then Gary Harris hits the three, and Michigan State's opened up a double-digit lead for the first time, and the second timeout used by New Orleans, with Michigan State leading 21-10.
Let's set the table. Early in this game, the Privateers took, I thought, good shots. And now, once you start to begin to shoot and not playing defense the way you want, nobody's talking on the weak side here. So when you come over to pick and roll, you have to talk, you have to hedge, you have to help out here. And when you don't do that on a guy like Gary Harris, you try to go underneath the screen, you can't do it. KYP, know your personnel. You know you got a catch-and-shoot player. You have to be able to trail over the top and force Gary Harris off of the three-point line.
BTN goes wherever you want it with BTN To Go, presented by Auto Owners Insurance. Watch live hoops on your computer, tablet, or smartphone. BTN To Go is now available to all major subscribers who receive BTN through their cable, satellite, or video providers. To learn more, visit btntogo.com, also available in the App Store and on Google Play. No matter where you're watching this game, whether on your television or on your smartphone or on wherever, you're seeing a 12-0 run by Michigan State right now over the last 3 minutes. And New Orleans in a world of trouble. Darren Becker trying to break the run, and he does with the three.
And prime example, out of timeout, you call a play. You're patient. You work the defense a little bit. Now you get a high percentage shot. That's something we saw early in the game, and that's why it was closer before they started to kind of jack up four shots.
Bird has the rebound. Second chance for Michigan State. Appling open for three. And Appling rattles home his second made three. 10th point of the first half. Mack with his squad down 11. Broyles on the drive down the baseline. And the rebound to Valentine. Long lob ahead. Appling, here we go. Two-handed for Keith Appling.
Coaches always talk about this, Kevin. If the guard drives, the opposite guard has to get back. That time, the Privateers' backcourt just kind of got caught looking and didn't get back in transition.
Darren Becker was begging for that ball, and he hits the three.
Well, I see why. The lefty with a beautiful stroke. But, you know, you can't trade baskets with the Michigan State team. It's a no-win situation. So you have to shore up the defensive end if you're the Privateers and want to make any kind of run.
Nice catch by Payne inside. A lot of defense around him. Can't get the roll. And tracked down by Kevin Hill. Royals in the corner for three. And he gets the kind roll, and the Privateers back within seven. Back-to-back threes for New Orleans. Valentine, uncontested layup for Michigan State.
It's almost like a football play, running back finding the hole off the back end of the tackle. And Adrian Payne doing a good job of sealing his guy in the lane, opening up the driving lane for Denzel Valentine.
Mack around the Dixon screen, backs it out to Hill. Hill with a long contested jumper, and the rebound, Hill gets his own. A little bit strong on the floater, and this time Michigan State able to clear it with Denzel Valentine. Bird for three. And an air ball caught by Broyles. Crowd was ready to erupt a little bit if Russell Bird had hit that one, but came up more than a little empty.
You know, that time the three-point line, I don't know what it is in the corner, was it 21 feet? At about 23. A little too excited, but
there's always another opportunity.
There's always enough, but you put it up because it was in transition. It was a good shot, just a little too much mustard on that one.
And now here's a little bit of the game plan that we talked with Coach Schlesinger about. Ryan winding that shot clock down, and with two on the shot clock, Corey Dixon hits the jumper.
Well, efficient possession that time by the Privateers, but then you don't get back on defense, okay? Keith Appling misses the shot, but now they have another opportunity.
You turn it over and then commit the foul. And Michigan State goes into the timeout up by seven.
Kevin, Michigan State getting back to what we know best. Contesting shots, blocking shots. Now you get out in transition. Keith Appling doing what he does best. Michigan State up 28-21.
Built a 13-point lead, but Jim Jackson, an 8-2 run for New Orleans, has cut that lead down to seven again.
Patience. Half-court execution, kind of taking the air off the ball, forcing Michigan State to guard multiple passes. And as a result, the Privateers have been able to get some high percentage shots, and now they're knocking them down. So that's why they've been able to get back. And again, switching defense. Now they're back into a 2-3 zone. Let's see if Michigan State can attack the middle once again.
Appling with 12 has matched his point total of the last two games combined going to work to Trice. On the floor for Michigan State, Colby Wallenman out there for the first time today. Just his fifth game played this year. He's only seen action for 9 minutes. Coach Izzo looking for a little bit of a spark and a little bit of foul trouble with Gauna and Schilling each having two fouls. Nine to shoot for Trice. The pull-up jumper, and he splashes it home.
Well, that was very good recognition by Travis Trice, knowing that after the ball went out of bounds, the Privateers came back in man-to-man.
Good pass inside. Tough work down low, though, for Sion, and Appling pushing the other way. Valentine, the trailer, for three. And back up to a 12-point lead for the Spartans.
How many times have we seen it, Kevin? A trailing man inside, open for the three. But in the previous play, recognition. That's what your point guards are supposed to do. Travis understands Trice that it's a man-to-man. So now he switches the play up, goes against, uses the screen, and has a nice little pull-up. So that's experience right there, knowing what your scouting report is, knowing they'll switch defenses, able to get a high percentage shot there by Travis Trice.
First foul a moment ago on Adrian Payne. That's five fouls on Michigan State, four on the Privateers. Mack on the bounce, taken away. Valentine trying to push. Back up to Valentine. Good look inside to Payne, and Payne muscling it to the basket.
Valentine with the push, receives it back. Excellent post position inside by Adrian Payne.
That 8-2 run for New Orleans countered by an ongoing 7-0 run for Michigan State. And the ball out of bounds. Spartans with a chance to build on that run. And the defense has been ratcheted up a notch once more for Michigan State.
That's been one of the calling point and calling cards for this Michigan State program over the years. When they've been very successful, competed for national championship, the defense has kind of led the way. And then offense followed right behind him. And that's something that Coach Izzo talked about, getting his team back to that kind of defensive intensity and physical nature.
Corey Dixon with the foul inside, the hold on Adrian Payne. So Dixon's foul sends us to a timeout with Michigan State leading by 14.
Pushes himself inside for an easy basket, but because he's able to drag the defense down, Valentine over to Appling inside. As the defense rotates back up, now Adrian Payne is able to get inside, seal position. Excellent pass by Valentine inside. The show hand by Adrian Payne indicates where he's open and wants the ball. Big men are taught. Run down the middle of the court, you open up a lot of things. That right there is well-executed transition basket by the Spartans.
And that's an area Tom Izzo told us earlier today that they've really missed Matt Costello, who's been out with mono, because he does that exceptionally well on the break, runs right down the middle. Trice with the little lob to Adrian Payne. Payne does that pretty well.
Speaking about down the middle, making yourself available, but the key with Costello is this. You don't necessarily have to receive the ball, but someone on the opposing team has to pay attention to you. So now that opens up, you know, those spot up 3-point shots because you sprint down the middle of the court.
Yeah, Keith Appling really has a lot of room to operate when Costello's doing that. The lob inside taken away by Payne. Appling with a bounce to Harris. Oh my goodness! Harris with a one-handed stuff and he's fouled. Spectacular play by Gary Harris.
Once again, what's out of the play? Deflection, up, one dribble, one pass, and a finish. Okay? No wasted motion, no wasted dribbles, no wasted time. As a result, Gary Harris posterized play and had a chance to get to the free throw line for a 3-point play.
And that's one that got you out of your seat a little
bit. Yeah, I kind of jumped back a little bit. I almost fell back and hit this bracket and brace behind me. I got excited.
I don't want that to happen. Nine for Harris. None better than that. The lob down to Bourgeois and the reverse won't go. And the rebound out of bounds to Michigan State. 3:06 to go in the first half, and you can still hear the buzz here at the Breslin Center after that wonderful dunk by Gary Harris.
One thing you got to keep in mind about this Michigan State team is that, you know, they take such great advantage when they're playing well of getting the ball up the court quick. and not trying to dribble and beat the defense themselves. They advance it with the pass.
Mack on the drive to the basket, and Mack breaks a 12-0 Michigan State run. 7 points for Mack, hustling to the other end. Appling is fouled, and he'll go to the line.
You know the beauty about that, Kevin? 4 seconds went off the shot. From the moment the ball went in the basket, the deep outlet pass to Keith Appling around the hash mark, and now 4 seconds later, you're at the free throw line shooting two.
That foul, the third on Darren Becker. And that's a big loss because Darren Becker's been their most consistent outside shooter. He's got 3 threes, 9 points, and now 3 fouls. So Darren Becker sits down. Averaging 12 and a half points per game, and over the last 3 games, almost 15 points per game for Matt Darren Becker.
Well, the backcourt puts so much pressure on you to get back. Because you score, you can't sit there and kind of just look at it and celebrate the basket. You have to get back. And if you don't, you're not in position. And guess what? You pick up a cheap foul.
Isaac Mack. Sion looking down low and almost threw it away. Mack now trying for three. Rebound tipped over to Sion. Good pass down low. McPherson with an easy two.
The Privateers have done a really good job, I think, offensive rebound. Now, they haven't been able to convert, but they show you some of their skill and athleticism, even though they're undersized, to get to the offensive board, and that time resulted in the easy two inside.
Well, you got to remember, this is a New Orleans team that's just in the process of building. 2 years ago, they had 3.5 scholarships total. 8 a year ago. This is the first year that they've got the full 13 scholarships that they're offering. So the foul with a chance, some free throws here. 41-25, Michigan State with the lead, a minute 53 remaining. State Farm halftime report is coming up. Mike Hall, Scooney Penn, Tim Doyle, bringing you all the news from around the Big Ten and the busy post-Christmas Saturday. That's all coming up next on the State Farm halftime report.
Let's go back to Coach. You talked about Schlesinger and about building the program. He said he really loves where the program is at. He really truly enjoys coaching these young men because they're responsive. You don't have a player here there being a knucklehead. When there's changes needed to be made, they respond. And when you have that kind of input with players who respond, it makes coaching a lot easier. It makes it more exciting. But also, too, now from a recruiting perspective, building a program, you have solid guys that can go out and begin to do something special.
McPherson driving down the baseline. Oh, my goodness. That took forever, but he got the roll. 4 for McPherson.
You see McPherson loves to get to the basket. That's about the second or third time that he's been able to get to the basket and finish this time. But, again, that's really good offense by the Privateers, but also that's poor defense of giving up the baseline if you're Michigan State.
Trice around the Payne screen. Open in the corner for three. Valentine can't connect, and Mack the rebound. New Orleans with 56 seconds to play until halftime. Dixon lost it, got it back. Now Dixon, the reverse down the baseline, and Valentine the rebound.
It's just been tough on Dixon all afternoon.
And Appling is fouled. He'll go to the line for a pair. Now the Privateers still battling, Jim.
Well, they're still battling. Look, you get to the basket and just kind of rolls around the rim a little bit, teeters out there, falls in. But when they attack and they move Michigan State, they're able to find those little gaps, okay? So you take that if you're the coaching staff and say, listen, guys, at halftime, here's where we've been successful. When we've kind of been patient, move the defense, and then attack.
You thought that was a slow-motion replay that we showed. That was full speed with that ball rolling around the rim like that. Somebody get a hold of Sir Isaac Newton. Gravity's not working the way it should here in East Lansing.
Touched every part of the rim on that one.
Appling, 15 points and 6 assists in the first half. Safe to say the mini slump he'd had the last couple of games has come to an end.
And why is that important? Because you enter in the Big Ten play on the road at Indiana, a place that is hostile enough, okay? So you want to be in a comfort zone and a level where shooting the basketball, you're not thinking about it, you're more reactive. And the way you do that is by seeing the ball go in the basket, and that's what we've seen early in this first half by Keith Appling.
Well, one of the things Michigan State, as we mentioned, they've done all year, they've shared the ball in this first half, 13 assists on 17 field goals. Second in the nation in assists this year and living up to the billing. Sion on the drive with a left hand. Bird commits the foul, and Sion will go to the line.
And Ellis has to shift over a little bit. That time he was married to his guy on the wing. And immediately when you see that drive beginning to take place, you have to get your body in front and force Sion to give the ball up.
It's been a real weak spot in the game of Terrence Sion. 4 for 17 now at the foul line this year. And a guy at 6'6", who figures going into conference play in the Southland, going to be able to get to the basket a little bit, but he's got to be able to make free throws, and ugly's two there. 4 for 18 at the line.
And let's see if Michigan State right here closes out the half with the kind of shot they want. You're going to run the clock down. You want to attack it about 8 seconds left, but I would imagine that it may involve some kind of pick and roll, trying to get Adrian Payne sealed inside.
And a timeout with 9.7 seconds to go until halftime. The use it or lose it timeout taken by Michigan State. And a 44-27 lead for the Spartans. Well, our full day of hoops continues next when Michigan battles Holy Cross. Eric Collins and Stephen Bardo have all of the action. Then we put a bow on the day's action as Richard Pitino's Gophers take on Texas A&M Corpus Christi. Coverage continues after our game on BTN and BTN to go.
Kevin, I like these situational timeouts. It allows coaches to pull out a play or two they need to work on against live bodies other than in practice, okay? And whether you make or miss a shot, sometimes isn't as important how you execute the play. And so let's keep our eye on, again, 9.7 seconds left, go into attack mode and see if Michigan State can kind of get the kind of shot that the coaching staff wants to get out of this timeout and out of this play.
Valentine to Trice.
And zone defense out of it again. Smart play that time by the coaching staff of the Privateers, knowing that Coach Izzo was going to try to run something against a man-to-man, you come out in zone.
Seventh turnover for Michigan State, although the first in a while. They had a flurry early in the game, and we've gone about 7 or 8 minutes without a Michigan State turnover until there. Long three as we reach halftime. No good from Nate Fry. And halftime is here with a score of Michigan State 44, New Orleans 27. Let's send it to Chicago for our State Farm halftime report. Mike Hall, Scooty Penn, Tim Doyle, they're ready to go and get you all caught up on Big Ten action. Thanks to our man Mark Hall, who put that little montage together. You now know everything that happened in the first half. So if you're just tuning in, you saw every single thing that happened in the first half to help Michigan State get to that 17-point lead.
And let me clarify that, not Mike Hall.
No.
His friend there in the studio, Mark Hall.
Mike Hall wouldn't do that kind of stuff.
Exactly.
Our MFS inside the numbers in that first half. 7 offensive rebounds for the Spartans, 22 points in the paint, and those 19 fast break points, something head coach Mark Schlesinger of New Orleans was very concerned about when we talk with him pregame.
Well, Debbie, you know as well as I do, that has been the identity of this program, rebounding and been able to get out in transition. So we saw the making of Michigan State kind of getting back to what they're accustomed to doing.
And a foul away from the ball on Gavin Schilling. Schilling got into foul trouble in that first half. That's his third. And Schilling just 9 seconds in picking up his third personal foul.
And look where that foul took place. I mean, it was up. Free throw line extended, probably not affecting the play as much. Again, freshman trying to figure it out. And those are the growing pains of sometimes inconsistent playing time, but also being a freshman trying to figure out how to play at this level.
Well, he plays very hard, but sometimes you have to know when to translate that hard play into smart play.
Well, you know, when he earns the consistent minutes, he'll be able to figure that out. But it's tough when you play in spurts at times because you want to play hard, but sometimes that can result into some errors mentally.
Back up top for Mack, and the three won't go. The rebound, Payne, taking it away from Schilling. Valentine, as the Spartans have their first offensive possession of the second half.
And let's pay attention to the execution right here for Michigan State offensively. We see Schilling right here picking up another foul.
It's his fourth. And so Schilling with two fouls in the first 40 seconds of the second half, and Schilling sits down.
Coach Izzo is kind of like, got his hand on his hip, like, look, I'm trying to give you some time. I want you to get in there and get your feet wet, but you got to help me out a little bit. You can't pick up back-to-back fouls.
I didn't know you were a lip reader. That was really good.
You know what? Well, I've seen a lot of looks before. You know, trust me, I had a lot of coaches, so I know what a lot of body language is really talking about.
Can't translate what he said there.
No. No. Sometimes as a player, especially in particular when you come out of game, you don't want to read or hear what the coach has to say. You rather just walk to the end of the bench and sit out.
Hard to avert that gaze at times, though, when you're walking over there.
You feel it. It's like that warm feeling on the back of your neck. You know, when your father got mad at you, that's what you feel like when you come out the game after making multiple mistakes.
Broyles three, no good. Applin ripping the rebound away. And there's a foul in transition on McPherson. Second on Tre'Darius McPherson. Who says a little man can't rebound?
No, it's amazing when you start to make shots. Your overall game, you're more aggressive offensively, defensively, and something tells me Keith wanted that rebound.
I would say so. He's had a lot of want to in this game. He's played very well. Here's Harris, wide open for three. And the rebound to Darren Becker. Mack inside, a foul called on Denzel Valentine. Already three fouls against Michigan State in this second half. Valentine picking up his first.
And sometimes coming out of halftime when you're up big, the first thing you see is kind of the lack of attention to detail defensively on a team. And you see that with Michigan State. Half a second slow, you pick up three quick fouls.
It's got to be a hard thing to do, to keep that laser focus when you walk out and you see 17-point advantage. The three from Mack. And the rebound to Gary Harris.
Well, the good teams understand how to maintain that focus, okay, coming out of timeout. And what's very important is how you warm up. When you come out of halftime, you really have to get the blood flowing again in the layup line to get ready to play. If not, you wind up, like I think Michigan State right here, a half a step behind because you didn't warm up and get your mind right properly.
Appling open three, and he hits it again. Keith Appling with 19 points. Nice bounce back game for Appling after a couple of games a little bit off from the floor. Darren Becker trying to drive on Payne. Good defense by Payne. Down to the rebound. Valentine back to Appling. Harris for three. And Gauna, the offensive board, had it knocked out of his hands and saved inbounds by Corey Dixon.
Two open looks.
Dixon on the drive, and he's fouled.
We talked about Keith Appling. Just want you to keep your eye here. Going away from the basketball, but then we'll come back into the play. It's a misdirection play right inside off the screen. Again, defensively, when you look at it, if you're New Orleans, Mack has to understand that Keith Appling has knocked down three-point shots. So you can't go underneath the screen. You have to go over the top. And like I talked about, I said early in the first half, force Keith off of the three-point line.
Gauna's third foul sends him to the bench. Russell Byrd back on the floor. A little bit of foul trouble up front for Michigan State. Schilling with four, Gauna with three. One for two on that trip for Corey Dixon. Appling with the push.
Well, something subtle. Just that push okay, by Keith Appleman. You get the ball across half court at 31 seconds, okay? Now you have the full shot clock to kind of look at multiple options. It may not seem like a lot, but if you can get a quick jab at it, get a look. If not, now you still have plenty of time to set up a quality play in the half-court situation.
Already 7 fouls between the two teams in this second half. Just 2:35 into the second half. So kind of a ragged start for both teams.
Well, and how many of those fouls have been when someone has been attacking the basket? Not many.
No. Bird inside.
Was a throw in for another one.
Yeah, well, he was surprised that he got the pass. From
Valentine with the two. He's got 7. Darren Becker launching and hitting from three. That's 12 for Darren Becker, all on three-pointers. He's made 4 of them.
Did you see where he shot it from?
Well behind the arc.
I don't think Adrian Payne thought that he had that kind of range, but he could have stepped out a little bit further.
He had 17 a couple of weeks ago at LSU. Darren Becker also with a good game at Minnesota and at UTEP in their upset win on the road.
Well, he's a lefty as well. And that time he just overplayed the situation. You have to play solid when you're playing against a more athletic, taller, bigger player. Just that little lunge opened up the passing angle for Keith Appleman to get it down to Adrian Payne.
Gill's pass tipped out by Gary Harris. It'll stay with New Orleans. In comes Tre'Darius McPherson. Out goes Isaac Mack.
When you don't have pressure on the basketball player that's passing the ball, now you can get it inside. And then it's a double negative because inside you lunge for a steal and you give up an easy basket.
Darren Becker really feeling it now, forcing that one up, fading away at the top. And then the tip, and we almost got Corey Dixon in our laps over here.
Darren Becker said, I can make up for the my mistake on the defensive end by knocking down another three.
It's all right. You can come out from under the table now.
You know, I didn't even flinch on that. That time it was 14, more on your side, so I wasn't.
You weren't worried at all?
About you. No. As long as he wasn't on this side of the table where we're at, that was fine.
Just want to remember that. I wasn't concerned about you.
Because I knew your cat-like reflex.
Thank you.
Would have
adjusted. That's a good cover. And a timeout taken by Michigan State. 15:52 remaining in the second half. 51-31. 20-point lead for the Spartans. And he wasn't worried about me. That makes me sad. 20-point lead. Kevin Kugler and the always loving Jim Jackson back in East Lansing, Michigan State 51, New Orleans 31. Let's take a look at today's Reese's Perfect Combination.
You know, coaches always talk about fast break opportunities and it's monotonous. You get repetitive, it gets boring, but when it's done correctly, it's a thing to do. And right here is a prime example of Michigan State executing to perfection the fast break.
Well, conference play right around the corner, and it kicks off Tuesday night on BTN with a doubleheader. First, Tom Izzo's Spartans take on Penn State. Then it's the Huskers battling Iowa. Coverage starts at 5 p.m. Eastern, presented by Quicken Loans on BTN and BTN to go. You can follow these Spartans.
I am. I'm following the Penn State out of the timeout, Gary Harris.
Shot that one from State College and hit. And a timeout taken by New Orleans.
Yeah, the beautiful part of it, too, is I love going into conference play. And right now, this Michigan State team is starting to round itself into midseason form going into conference play.
54-31, Michigan State with a 23-point lead and 15:44 to go in the second half. And this is a nice break for a lot of people that had a real tough Christmas week around not only East Lansing, but the entire state of Michigan. Almost 500,000 people without power for the bulk of Christmas week because of this ice storm that hit right before Christmas. And a lot of folks, including some of the good folks on our crew, didn't get their power back until yesterday or the day before. So they've all been huddled around the campfires, and they were excited to see the Breslin Center back open because it's got power. They've got hot dogs. They've got hot and cold running water.
They got heat.
They've got heat.
You know, here's the thing. We talked about it in the car, how much we take for granted electricity until you don't have it.
You and I have many deep philosophical discussions on our way to basketball games. 15:30 remaining in this second half and a timeout on the floor. More deep philosophical thoughts when we return. And January 12th. It's the much-anticipated premiere of BTN's original series, The Journey, Big Ten Basketball 2014, as we take a closer look at the premier basketball conference and the people who live it. It premieres January 12th on BTN. Seen the crew out and around during the course of the non-conference season, and you know they're going to have some amazing stuff once again. It truly is a tremendous program. Cannot wait.
Outstanding insight into the lives off the court of the players and coaches and families. You know, it's interesting. This conference season is going to be a little bit different. Last year, we had a bit more star power individually. Mm-hmm. This year, a lot of collectively really good teams.
This team being one of those really good teams. As Appling is fouled, he'll go to the free throw line.
Yeah, and you don't have a lot of separation, I don't think, you know, between the top tier teams. You see Keith Appling now attacking off the dribble, one of the things that he does really well, and now staying with the shot. But you know, now what's the difference? Okay, you see Michigan State, Ohio State, Wisconsin near the top. You have Illinois playing good basketball. You have Iowa playing good basketball. Nebraska could be a place where you go and play now that's a little bit tougher. So it's not cut and dry. Michigan, you know, off of the setback with McGarry, but you still have quality players there. So it's going to be interesting. The teams that can take care of home court, you win the games you're supposed to, but who can go out on the road in the tough environment, tough venue, and get the win they're not supposed to get?
Appling with 20 points now. Only downside, 5-for-8 at the line after going 1-for-2 in that trip. 20 points, 7 assists, only 1 turnover as Gill launches the 3 and he hits. Only his third made 3 of the season. He's got 5.
Now that time Keith Appling went under 2 screens and Gill happy just stepped right behind the 3-point line for a contested shot.
Appling driving right into the teeth of that defense, and he's going to get back to the free throw line. The foul going on Kevin Hill. His first.
Well, these driving lanes are open from the simple fact, Kevin, that because you're able to space a Gary Harris on the wing, now you're caught in between, how much do I help off of Harris in order to stop the drive? Well, the rule is that you want to make the ball handler give up the ball. But now you see some indecisiveness a little bit in the privateers of when to stop ball and how much do I give up in order to negate Harris from catching and shooting.
Darren Becker back in. Dixon back in. Valentine with a breather. Trice on the floor. And Michigan State will have another substitution. As Appling hits the second free throw and onto the floor for the first time in several games, Kenny Kaminsky, who had been suspended indefinitely, but that suspension lifted today, and Kenny Kaminsky, who's played in 4 games this year, getting his first action in quite a while.
That's a good time. This Michigan State team, what we've been talking about across conference, play a little deflection here. It's the health of this team. You see, we haven't mentioned Brandon Dawson today. You know, kind of got a little bump and bruise there in practice, so coach and staff probably just, you know, letting him rest. But think about Travis Trice injury, Gary Harris a little injury. So can they stay healthy enough to kind of gel together? Because if they do that, you know, you can see how good they can be.
Kaminsky, wide open three. There's a way to turn to the lineup.
Welcome back, Kaminsky.
Launching the three and hitting. We're watching him in warm-ups today, and he was shooting from all around the perimeter and just stroking it.
Well, I like the confidence. You come in off a suspension, first open opportunity to get you, let it fly.
Nice dish underneath and the two-hand stuff for Corey Dixon. Good penetration and a good finish by Dixon. He's got 7.
That's the easiest basket that Dixon has been able to get in all afternoon.
Payne going to work against Dixon. Driving him down. Got his own rebound and Payne back in.
There's nothing the Privateers can do with Adrian Payne inside if they let him get that deep position.
Nice split of the defenders, and then Kaminsky there playing good defense. The save back in play, and it's scooped up by Appling, who is fouled by Bourgeois. Well, welcome back to the redshirt freshman, Kenny Kaminsky.
Well, the key is with Kaminsky here is that you create space, okay, and then you also trail the play enough. Now, the defense is going to be down below the free throw line, and you freeze it right there. Look at everybody. Backs are to Kaminsky and not really looking at him. So now you walk right into a three-point shot. Okay, it's recognition on his part, but also from a defensive perspective, again, just little things, but no one communicating, recognizing where your shooters are on the court.
We have some good minutes in that North Carolina game when there were a lot of injury problems, and then Kaminsky was suspended after that. Hasn't played since. Payne on the drive to the bucket. They count the bucket and the foul on Darren Becker. So Payne with the drive gets the hoop and the foul on Darren Becker, his fourth.
And how many bigs do you know at 6'10", 6'11", can do that? Not only can Adrian Payne step out and knock down the three, he's showing the ability to post up, the pull-up jump shot, but now to attack off the dribble. So now defensively, when you're looking at the scouting report and what to take away from Adrian Payne, he has multiple ways that he can beat you, which is a tougher way to defend. And I like to see Adrian where he doesn't get locked into settling for three, but he's on the attack like that.
Pretty quiet afternoon, early evening for Adrian Payne. 12 points, 4 rebounds.
But he's been imposing defensively inside, even though he may not have blocked a lot of shots. Just his presence in the lane has altered a number of shots by the privateer.
That's a foul on Adrian Payne, and that'll be his second. In for New Orleans comes Tevin Broyles, true freshman. And Isaac Mack will inbound for the Privateers. This Privateer squad has played a grueling schedule. Their strength of schedule coming into today was fourth in the nation. They were as high as number 2 in the nation a week ago.
But think about how that prepares these young men for conference play. I mean, it's nothing they haven't seen because of that tough early non-conference schedule.
Well, they've been at LSU. They played Boise State. That's a solid squad. They went to Hawaii. They played at Minnesota. And they played at and beat UTEP on the road.
Exactly. So that's a confidence booster in itself. Okay, so sometimes the wins may not have come, but the experience, and again, what the coaching staff talked about, Kevin, we see improvement game by game.
Foul on Dixon, his second, 8th team foul against the Privateers. Adrian Payne ready to go at the line. Already 14 fouls whistled in this second half. Again, just a little more rocky, ragged play. Now this is Payne on the season. 18.1 points per game, 8 rebounds, the reigning Big Ten Player of the Week.
And what you don't see is the mental growth of Adrian Payne. You see it in his numbers. But when he finally realized who he was as a player and what he can bring to the table, that's when those numbers began to shoot out the roof. And that's the mental part of the game that I think Coach Izzo and the coaching staff has always been trying to get Adrian Payne to understand. And more important, once he became, the mental part came, the consistency followed right behind him.
You know what I was impressed by was Coach Izzo making a point of saying how impressed he was with Adrian Payne when we were chatting with him earlier today. You don't necessarily have to say that about a superstar, but Coach Izzo wanted to be sure we knew how good his star has become.
Ability to put the ball on the deck and attack. He's a tough guard. I mean, do you take away the three-point shot? Do you take away the post up? What do you do? An added advantage that this Michigan State Spartan team has that a lot of teams don't post.
Does he have to be careful, though, not to fall too much in love with the three-point shot and neglect the post play?
Well, it's easy to do that because it's an easy shot in particular when you're trailing, pick and pop. You don't have to work as hard. But where he's going to make his money, where this team is really going to advance, is when he's able to dig deep, get deep post position inside, and dominate in the paint.
He's on the bench right now. We've got a whistle and a foul. Kaminsky getting tied up with Darren Becker, and Kenny Kaminsky with his first personal foul, and that'll bring the 1-on-1 into play for New Orleans. Well, you see that three-point shot in the first 87 games. Adrian Payne didn't shoot from three. The last 31, not only has he shot, he's become very effective, shooting 42% plus from behind the arc.
Well, you think about it. It's, one, you got to have confidence in yourself. But when your coaching staff has confidence in you, and allows you the freedom to shoot that shot. That elevates, I think, how you shoot the ball as well, in particular when you have a soft touch like Adrian Penn.
Ball kicked out of bounds. Surprisingly, no three-point shots today for Adrian Payne. As Gary Harris returns, Keith Applin sits down.
I'm going to take some credit for that.
Are you? Yeah, this is you?
Yeah. Because that shooter on, I said, don't fall in love with the three-point shot. So I'm right now, I'm taking credit for that.
Now, if he stops shooting the three for the rest of the year, you will get blamed by Spartan fans.
No, I'm not. I won't accept that.
Okay. Just want it on record. Trice trying to get it to Kaminsky, bobbled and out of bounds to New Orleans. Ninth turnover for Michigan State.
That time, Trice inside a little pocket pass to Schilling. Just couldn't corral it and get it in. Again, it's a lot of times when you're a freshman and you talked about inconsistent play, the game seems like it's moving 100 miles per hour. And until you kind of get into that space where the game can slow down, that little easy pass that you normally would catch seems very hard to kind of get.
Kicked out of bounds by Kaminsky. At what point does it slow down for a player, or does it vary individually?
It depends.
When did it slow down for you?
Well, I was
first game freshman.
I remember playing DePaul our first game, really first game, and the game seemed like it was going 100 miles per hour.
Mm-hmm.
We went through some preseason early conference tournaments. We got the doors blew off of us. But I learned a lot. And by the time we came back, maybe the eighth or ninth game, the game began to slow down. But again, it's how many minutes you're out there.
Right.
Which really determined for a player when that kind of light switch clicks on and the game slows down.
Dixon with a nice move inside. Cannot finish. Rebound picked up by Kevin Hill, and he gets the roll.
Master by 15, Hill.
Denzel Valentine now on the attack for the Spartans. And the pull up at the free throw line. A little bit strong. Valentine trying to crash and get the board, but it'll go the other way.
Valentine floating a little bit on that pull up jump shot. You like to see him two dribbles, hard stop and pull straight up and go vertical.
New Orleans came in shooting almost 52% from the floor in their last three games. 30% though in this game. Michigan State has cooled them off considerably.
But it's a different defense. You see right there talking about defense.
And now Gary Harris with a chance to put on a show. Not quite the degree of difficulty of his first half dunk, but enough to get a round of applause nonetheless. He's got 14.
But there was excellent help defense. That time he didn't stay married to his man. He got his body in front of the dribble and was able to stop it, and not only stop it, but to get a steal.
Dixon down the baseline, fighting through the pain block, and Valentine with the rebound. Trice, nice pick away by Bourgeois, and it went off the leg of Trice and out of bounds.
Right, keep your eye on Gary Harris right here with the help defense right there. Okay, in the proper place to get the steal, and now you're able to finish for an easy two. I want to oversell that because that's very important, because it's awareness defensively, being in the right place, okay? And in a critical situation, in a game when it counts, you have to be at that spot.
Part of the growth of a good player into a great player, that defensive play.
Well, that's part of being an overall really good defensive team. It can't just be one individual. All five players have to be on the string.
Shot clock down to five. Dixon with the fadeaway, and he hits it over Payne. Corey Dixon with the bucket. He's got nine.
But you can see the skill set of Dixon. I mean, he's just a little outmatched right now with Adrian Payne inside.
Timeout taken by Michigan State. And that backcourt for Michigan State leading the way. Appling today with 22 points. Harris has 14 points to pace the Spartans in the backcourt, and that backcourt has been the story so far this season for Michigan State.
Well, hasn't that been the case when Michigan State has made their runs, whether that was a Mateen Cleaves, a Kalen Lucas, guys of that nature, and also this guy hasn't even touched the court with his imposing will, averaging 13 points and over 10 rebounds the last three games. But when this Michigan State has been very competitive, it's been led by, I think, the backcourt really playing well. Even when Corey Lucius was here, Allen was here, when those guys were making it to the finals, the backcourt was a key ingredient to why they were able to play well. And then you combine the rebounding and tough defense. It was a physically tough team and tough team to stop.
And for Spartan fans who are wondering why Brandon Dawson's not out there, we should mention, bruised his shin in practice. And coach told us that, you know, he maybe could go, wasn't sure what he would do, but was probably for precautionary measures not going to play him in this game. They want him ready, healthy, and full bore for conference season.
Well, I like the fact that his mind is ready. After that North Carolina game, he didn't play well. He knew he didn't play well. And Coach Izzo let him know he didn't play well. But immediately he went back. He watched film. He watched film with Coach Izzo. And as a result, like I said, the last three games, 13 points, 10 rebounds, shooting over 55%.
And the lob inside the Schilling for two.
And you have
4 points for Schilling. 70-42, Michigan State. The crowd reacting, they get free tacos as a result of hitting 70 points. That's always reason to cheer. Well, Brandon Dawson, you mentioned watching film with Coach. Well, this is what's happening right now. Coach Dawson and Coach Izzo.
He's like, really? But here's the thing with Dawson. The beauty of having a Brandon Dawson is, one, you don't have to run plays for. He's physically imposing. Okay, he's a tough matchup. If it's a center guarding him, well, he's too big and too quick. If it's a smaller forward, he's too small. As you see, Gary Harris with the excellent ball movement. So he adds so much to this team that you can't kind of quantify, maybe in numbers. But if Michigan State really wants to make a run, Brandon Dawson is going to be a key ingredient.
Brandon Dawson with some tips for Coach Izzo. So far they're working. 73-42, Spartans with the lead. New Year's Eve, Ohio State, Purdue, Indiana, Illinois. This Michigan State squad taking on Penn State and Nebraska against Iowa. What a great way to start off conference season and end the new year. The records, Michigan State, Ohio State, Wisconsin, Iowa, right there at the top of the pecking order.
And some key games for some of the top teams. Michigan State on the road, Ohio State on the road. Tough, hostile environments early on in the conference season.
There's a steal by Isaac Mack. Mack on the push, picked his pocket, Gary Harris. And now numbers for the Spartans. Harris on the drive, the finger roll is good.
And once again, you're in proper position to make the correct defensive play. It's a little thing, but it's a big thing in regards to protecting the paint and playing very good overall team defense.
19 for Harris. His season high is 21 against Oklahoma.
But you notice this too about Gary Harris. When you have a really good team and good players around you, you don't have to work as hard. You don't have to force shots, which means now you can become much more efficient than trying to do everything yourself. And I talked about now the growth. You talked about the growth. Well, Gary Harris defensively. Now he's in position, doesn't overcommit, bam. Now you're able to get the steal. You're able to get out in transition, use your athleticism. A part of his growth as well.
Our coach says he wants that improvement to continue. Talking about Gary Harris with us earlier today, and he just said, you know, this kid he's tremendous, but I want to see that improvement continue. And he has seen the improvement continue from freshman year to sophomore year with Gary Harris.
I understand the pressure, because when I was a sophomore, being picked as well with Steve Smith as far as, you know, player of the year candidates. Mm-hmm. Here's the thing about it, and I go back to it. The better teammates you have, the easier it is on you as a player. And if you use your teammates correctly. And that's part of where I think he's really going to improve, is that he can not force things.
And a foul on Terrence Sion as Appling hits the deck. And that second chance came from Gary Harris on the bounce.
Look, right here, just inside, a little bounce pass right off the deck to Keith Appling.
Pretty good vision to see that little opening there and be able to thread the ball through those two defenders.
Well, I don't think he gets enough credit too for some of the playmaking ability and passing ability he has. It may not be flashy, but passing on time and on target is as important to get your teammate an open look.
Appling at the line for the 1-1. And he's got 23 points, 8 assists, and 5 rebounds. Gary Harris with 19 points. And you're going to have a fun one on New Year's Eve, the backcourt of Michigan State against that Penn State backcourt. That's a great matchup.
Well, DJ Newbill averaging about 19 points. Timmy Frazier right there at about 18 and a half against Keith Abling and Gary Harris. Okay, so you're talking about having one of those prime time events where the guards are going to kind of dominate the spotlight a little bit. And I'm looking forward to that. I'm so happy that, you know, Frazier is back and playing well. I mean, it's
great to see, isn't it?
Yeah, great testament to that young man's fortitude and work ethic to get back to playing at a high level. I don't think he's really there yet to where he ultimately could be.
Appling open three, and he hits it again. Keith Appling with 27 points and an 80-42 Spartan lead. Trying to answer on the other end, it pinballs out from James Harrison. Second chance opportunity now for the Privateers.
And chilling right there, a learning lesson. You can't use your athleticism all the time. You have to put a body on your opponent, that time being Sion. By not doing that, you give up an offensive rebound.
Down low, turning to the basket, nothing there. And a foul is called.
Number five.
Well, tonight it's the finale presented by Reese's. Our guys in the studio break down the full day of basketball with highlights and analysis tonight, 10:30 Eastern on BTA. So Schilling fouling out, Appling sitting down, and Appling may be done for the day with 5:28 to play. And if he is, he's tied his career high with 27 points that he had against Oklahoma earlier in the year.
Get in, get your work done.
I'd say 27 points, 8 assists, 5 rebounds. It's a pretty good day at the office.
A little towel fight on the bench.
And only one turnover.
Yeah, that's the key, too. Because at times in the past, Keith could be a little loose with the ball. But as you've seen of late, really valuing each possession.
Trice backing out for three. On the feed from Gauna.
The two-man basketball, that's how you push real quick inside out. But outstanding recognition by Gauna as well, recognizing that Trice was open behind the three-point line.
That started on the 13th rebound from Denzel Valentine. That's a career high for Valentine, and Harris able to take that one away.
Guess who?
And poked out of bounds by Corey Dixon.
You know, initial push right now, you get Gauna inside on the post, and because it's a quick inside, no one's there, relocation by Trice to the three-point line. It looks easy, but these are things that coaches work on each and every day in practice, relocation, in and out. And when it's executed, you know, coaches say, see, now I told you, it works when you do it correctly.
Valentine for three. And the rebound tipped over to Gary Harris. Valentine will try again. This time he hits.
Valentine.
10 points, 13 rebounds for Denzel Valentine, and 6 assists. Not a bad stat line for Valentine. Back-to-back games with career highs and rebounds for Valentine. 11 against Texas, and now 13 against New Orleans. 24 boards for Valentine in the last two games. And Gary Harris with a terrific game as well. Really, you look up and down the stat sheet, and this Michigan State squad's done well, but Gary Harris has really shined today.
Well, it's quietly he got his work done. Because he's not a volume shooter, you look up and he's in double digits. You're like, well, how did he get there? Well, defensively, you create opportunities, you get out in transition. That knocked down a couple of three-point shots. So not being a volume shooter, I think sometimes masks what his productivity is, because he's not shooting 20 or 30 times a game.
Harris, 19 points, 9 rebounds, 5 assists, and 5 steals tonight for Gary Harris.
We talked about growth, too. And Denzel Valentine is one of those guys that last year, he showed the potential to be a playmaker, but a lot of times got caught in the air with trying to make a fancy pass. But now he's learning when to go, when to pull the trigger, what's a good pass, what's not, because he can create, as we've seen in this game, multiple scoring opportunities for his teammates, either off the dribble, off the pass. So his growth has been charted well and seen as well.
They've held New Orleans defensively to 5 of 20 from the floor in the second half. I bring that up because against Minnesota, New Orleans shot 55% in the second half. As Ellis hits the three, and there's going to be a timeout because Corey Dixon got injured on the way up the floor.
You don't want to see that. Good coaching staff for the Privateers, because he's your main guy inside. Okay. And despite that he hasn't played extremely well, shot the ball well this afternoon, you know what he can give you in conference play. Okay, so let's keep an eye right here on the jump shot. If he comes down on right, just pull it up. And hopefully it's just a strain, then they can stretch it out. But you need him healthy if you want to make any kind of noise in conference.
No question about that. And he had come in red hot as Darren Becker gets the bucket and the foul. So Darren Becker, who's had a nice game, will go to the line for a chance at a three-point play. But it's all Michigan State at home.
And the team's ninth. We'll take timeout on the floor. Timeout for the Farm Bureau.
Easy opening slate, and because you're going on the road. Okay, at Penn State, you talked about the backcourt there. You go to Indiana, a very tough place to play, even though they're young this year, but they're leading the conference in rebounding. Then you play at home against Ohio State. So when you look at that, you always chart and say, let's take one game at a time. Well, that Penn State game is critical, I think, for Michigan State to establish who they want to be in conference play. If you can go into Penn State and dominate early, come out of there with that feel-good win. Now going into Indiana, you have momentum on your side against a young, aggressive, hungry Hoosier team.
Mm-hmm. And it's not like this Spartan team doesn't know who they are right now. They've been tested. They've played Kentucky. They've played Oklahoma. They've played North Carolina. They've played and won at Texas. This is a team that has really never been afraid in the Tom Izzo era to play anybody and everybody. They've tested themselves this year, and they think they're ready for conference players. Payne muscles it up, and he'll go to the line for a chance at a three-point play.
And here's the challenge right here, is that because of the injuries we talked about, you didn't have consistency. We talked about six starting lineups. I'm making a starting lineup. Adrian Payne now inside. So now, how good can this team really be when you have everybody healthy? That's the next phase, the next step, that how we evaluate this Michigan State team is when the core group is together for multiple games.
Payne's free throw gives him 17 points, 6 rebounds, and that's the capper on his day here at the Breslin Center as he leads to a nice round of applause from the faithful in East Lansing. Solid night for Adrian Payne. Got his work in and now gets a few minutes off. The reigning Big Ten Player of the Week, 17 points, 7 rebounds. The three off for New Orleans. Back out to Darren Becker. This Privateer squad going to fall short today in East Lansing, but Mark Schlesinger's got this program going in the right direction. And, you know, there are all the rumors. Are they going D3? Are they going D2? They're D1. They're staying D1. They're building in that direction. And after a lot of time today with Coach Schlesinger, you feel like this program's in very good hands.
Well, if I'm Coach Schlesinger, I don't beat my team up. You know, some things I think effort-wise where they probably could have battled better. But what I would do is take a look at and break down some film of when we executed, the team executed well. Okay, right there you got to get back on defense, okay? But I would take it and break it down and say, guys, when we've really been able to slow down the game and make multiple passes, we've got high percentage shots. But these right here are plays we need to correct, in particular on the defensive end.
Well, a guy that Coach Schlesinger wants to build his program like, Tom Izzo, and that's the role for this program. 8 straight weeks, ranked in the top 5. Of course, going to take a while to get to that 21 mark that they set from 2000 to 2001. But if you talk with Mark Schlesinger, a guy who grew up in Indiana, huge fan of the Hoosiers, mom's an usher, grandma loves IU and loves college basketball as a whole. But talked to Coach Schlesinger, and he said, one guy I'd like to model my program after is the guy on the opposite sideline tonight, Tom Izzo.
And Kevin, do you think it's model after the win or the way he relates to his players, the overall effect that he has on these young men outside of just the win?
That's the sense I got from Coach Schlesinger, was that, yeah, the wins are big, but he thinks that the wins come as a result of the total program that Coach Izzo's put together, and that's what he's trying to model.
Well, I think if you talk to any current or former players, you see excellent ball moving again by Michigan State. It's the love affair in a good way in regards to a father figure, okay, of what Coach Izzo was able to impart upon these young men during their time here. as how to not only just become a better basketball player, okay, which is important, but to grow as a young man into a man while you're here during your 3-4 years or whatever it may be.
Now, Coach Schlesinger and Coach Izzo are going to substitute and clear the benches, give everybody a chance to play. Mom Barbara got a chance to see Coach Izzo up close. Probably not real thrilled with what his team did to her son's team, but she was a treat to. We went over and introduced you to her earlier, one of her least favorite players in her time as a IU usher.
We didn't get a shot of the father.
No.
He didn't say a word.
Dad didn't say anything.
Dad was just like, okay, I'm here. All right, just talk to mom.
And a chance for a couple of free throws for Trevor Bonhoff. The foul going on Michael Walker.
Can we get a pan and look at dad?
Well, dad's face has not changed.
It hasn't changed since shooter.
No.
Okay.
That's how dad looked on the plane on the way up. That's how he looked on the way home.
Has not changed a bit.
Now, son's facial expressions have changed a little
well,
bit.
He has a few reasons. Okay, this is a heck of a challenge to come in here, but dad is holding on to that railing right there.
You get the sense that Barbara's running the show a little bit?
No question.
She's ushering that family around as well.
Happy wife. Happy life.
Yep. And Bonhoff with the chance to get into the scoring column. Rotate around to Nate Frye. Frye on the drive to the basket, and Frye with two. Nice little take by Nate Frye.
Nate Frye.
Ellis, the finger roll won't go. The tip try won't go. And the rebound to New Orleans. Gannapomo. And the rebound to Dan Chapman. 103 and counting to play. Michigan State has been in the driver's seat throughout this one. The three, Wetzel won't hit. Chapman with a rebound. The fadeaway for Chapman is good.
Let me get the bench. The reaction to the bench says it all. These guys that are playing right now put a lot of work in practice. You know, they don't get a lot of playing time, so when it's their chance to shine a little bit, their teammates pull for them. And you can see it by the reaction on the shot that went in and the excitement by the bench.
Well, and Chapman was the only Spartan not to score this year. And he's finally in the scoring column.
Yeah, listen to the crowd. Now, you really don't want to shoot at this particular point because you're up. You kind of want to hold it. But because of the crowd and the excitement, and one.
Colby Wallenman with the biggest ovation at the Breslin Center tonight.
And this is in the spirit of not trying to rub it in the face of New Orleans at all. Okay, let's keep that in mind. This is this great hustle that time Chapman with the turnaround inside and follow up.
And now Wallenman can't convert on the 3-point
play. He got the two. So,
well, you know, Coach Schlesinger understands this.
Yeah.
This is not rubbing it in. This is just some guys who never get the chance to play with a chance to play. And there's an offensive foul, so one more opportunity.
And I watch Wallenman right here. Patient inside, a little jump hook on the baseline. Said I've been working on that all summer to get that shot off.
And now New Orleans is going to take a timeout, I think, just because Mark Schlesinger is not happy with that last charge call.
Well, I mean, get your money's worth. Okay?
Absolutely.
You came here, you argue the call, say, hey, listen, I didn't see what you saw. Look, watch the bench. Look at everybody off the bench. Look at that. Everybody's off the bench. Look, Gowner's waving the towel like Larry Bird. They won the championship against the Lakers. You know, and that is the definition, I think, of why team sports are so critical.
Mm-hmm.
And why they mean so much. A lot of times you get lost in the shuffle about individualism. But right here you see they appreciate the hard work that goes into sacrifice for guys who, you know, as they know, once you get in a conference play, really not going to play.
12 Spartans have scored in this game tonight.
I tell you what, too, you better cheer for one of these guys, too, because they're going to end up running a company someday.
Exactly, and hiring you.
And hiring you. So you may want to keep that friendship close to the vest right there.
Why are you looking at me when you say this? Do you know something I don't?
I didn't hit you with the elbow in the side. I didn't do that
at all. This pink slip you've just handed me. I'll open that later. Ellis, with 2 seconds to go, will dribble this one out, and Michigan State closes the non-conference season with a resounding win, 101-48, the final at the Breslin Center. 56 points from Appling, Harris, and Valentine combined. That'll do it from East Lansing with our score, 101-48, Michigan State with the win. Coming up, it's the Big Ten Game Break with Mike Hall and the gang, bringing you up to date with a busy Big Ten Saturday. For Jim Jackson, I'm Kevin Kugler saying so long from the Breslin Center. Our final score, Michigan State 1.